Hello, welcome to Contact. I'm Gloria Crichton. And with me today at Anderson's restaurant is a man of many colors, or a man who wears many hats, Dr. Cecil Hershler, specialist in physical medicine and rehabilitation, also a researcher at UBC, storyteller and actor. Welcome, Cecil. Or is it Cecil? How do you like?
I prefer Cecil, but it's whatever you feel comfortable with.
Great. Yeah. Welcome. As I say, you're a very busy man.
You've got
many talents and you're involved in many worthwhile endeavors. But let's start in with your practice. You are a doctor and you have a practice in Vancouver.
Right. I have a private practice, and essentially I work from Mondays to Thursdays. And I would say that I essentially deal with people that have chronic pain, chronic illness, some form of disability that's ongoing. And more often than not, it deals with muscles and nerves.
Is that right? So you now... Chronic, traditionally with medicine, when one has chronic pain, usually the answer is a lot of medication to treat the pain. Your approach is a little different.
Right.
Tell us about it.
Well, chronic pain, to my mind, is one of those areas of medicine that's the least understood. I don't think we understand why it is that one can be injured at one point in time and then have that pain ongoing for many years. And from my point of view, it doesn't make sense to be medicating the person for that length of time.
Is it a short-term fix?
Well,
medication?
Medication at times can temporarily alleviate it, but then you always find the pain returns and you have to take more medication. And then often it runs into problems with respect to the side effects of the medication or the long-term effects of it. And so what I've tried to do is set up a so-called holistic approach to chronic pain. And this involves a traditional approach as well as some more non-traditional approaches. And the traditional approach is like any doctor, it's taking the story, the history, it's examining the person, it's doing any investigations that are necessary, although often by the time the patient comes to me, he or she has had a whole raft of investigations. So I tend not to be doing too many of those investigations. So it's once you have the story, the physical examination, I try to look at how that person's functioning in life. And I guess the objective is to try and get that person to rehabilitate or get back into life to the maximum of his or her capacity within their chronic pain.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. Challenging work.
It is challenging.
But very rewarding. Just to get back to chronic pain for a bit, Cecil, very often we think of chronic pain as something, say, with cancer that's localized, you know, terrible pain in the head with the tumor or the stomach. Does it go deeper than that? Is it probably a symptom of something deeper, the pain?
Well, you know, I think it's very difficult to answer that question. I think that pain often starts off and presents as a physical symptom. But because it's long-term and it's ongoing, there are a lot of emotional sequelae, we call it, or secondary
effects.
Yeah,
that's what I was getting at.
Right.
Yeah.
So it is deeper in that sense, that it begins to affect the emotion, the mood. Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean, as it is commonly represented, that the pain is in your mind, because that's what sometimes people say, it's imaginary pain.
Exactly.
Or you're malingering, or unconsciously you're...
It's all in the head.
And I think that can actually be a detriment to recovery.
Yeah.
I think there's no doubt that if you have ongoing physical pain, it begins to affect you at a deeper level. And when I say deeper, I think it affects the emotions, the moods, even your very spiritual being.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the true approach to chronic pain, and it's my approach, is to look at all those aspects.
Mm-hmm.
So, in this connection,
can we talk about your hero's journey?
Right.
And your exciting group that meets.
Well, we have a small group that we've started with in my office. That is a group of patients with chronic pain that have had numerous attempts to relieve that pain, including vast arrays of conservative physiotherapy, massage therapy, even chiropractic treatment. So a lot of physical maneuvers have been done which doesn't change the pain. They've been investigated with the highest technology with no obvious lesion being found that could be surgically corrected. And these people have chronic ongoing pain. So what we've started is, although we haven't given up on the physical, and by that we look at breathing, we look at posture, we look at movement, we look at it improving the design of their workplace or their house to give them the most comfort within the pain, we're also starting to look at the the mental side, so to speak, of the pain. And we've started a small group in which two facilitators work with the patients. Eva is a physiotherapist and a woman that's done a lot of workshop work on herself, transformational work, and Dale is a writer. And then I come in with, let's talk about Eva and Dale will take these people on a journey, in a real journey, helping them to identify what are their obstacles, what are their goals, what are the things that are making them stop journeying from where they are to a certain destination. What are the rewards? What are the gains? What are the pitfalls? So trying to identify that and thus give more insight to what's happening to them. I come into that group on a limited basis to take them on a parallel journey. We call each person that has chronic pain a hero, because basically
they are heroes.
They carry this burden of pain, therefore they are a hero. Mm-hmm. And because they have the pain that's ongoing, it's a journey. So my role is to enter in and to take them on a parallel mythological journey. So they have to create an imaginary hero, an imaginary name, an imaginary circumstance. Where does this hero live? What happened to this hero that he or she had to leave their village? What catastrophe occurred? What happens on the journey? What pitfalls? What obstacles? But it's purely in the mythological or imaginary realm. And the objective is to show people that, in fact, your mythology and your real life interweaves, and that one can help the other in terms of gaining more insight. Now, the next big step from that is the hypothesis that if you do this journey and you do this inner work, you will get more insight about what's happening to you, and that it will then start to feed back and help you cope with the pain better and perhaps even help the pain to be less. Mm-hmm. But that's
Wonderful.
A hypothesis. That's a next step. Yeah.
Wonderful. Do you think you're dealing with myth and with heroes and clans and tribes? Do you think that there's a lot of that missing in our modern society now? We don't, you know, there's a lot, we have the nuclear family, a lot of computer technology, business, people feel alienated in the workplace, in their personal lives. Do you think that maybe perhaps a lot of the pain, certainly not the, you know, the pain that you're dealing with, but a lot of pain or mental pain does occur because of the lack of this myth and ritual in today's society?
Yeah, I think that's a separate issue, and I think it's a think what you said is true. I think that we have become more alienated within the workforce and within our own extended and nuclear families. We've become more fragmented, more isolated. In the workplace, we're asked to do more and become more efficient. People don't tend to listen that much when we complain or appreciate. We don't give as many good strokes to people. Yeah. We tend to be more critical.
Yeah, we don't have the tribes and the clans and the grandparents to help out with the young, and it's tough.
One of the features of North American and Canadian society is that the young people do tend to leave home and go to places far away from them, from where they lived. So that makes it extended and fragmented. Mm-hmm. So the clan is diluted.
Mm-hmm. Now, paralleling your hero's journey, there's the healing journey that you're involved with Anne Mordafy.
Right. Some of the ideas that I've just expressed to you about taking people with chronic pain and helping them go on a hero's journey came out of a project that I did with Anne Mordafy and Trish Grange, where we took eight people. Each of them had severe diagnoses. One had terminal cancer, another young woman had AIDS. People had polio, chronic pain, intestinal disorders. So these eight people came on a journey with us through three weekend workshops, and we asked them to take with them a friend or family member and a therapist. And the therapists varied from physiotherapists, occupational therapists, massage therapists, to family doctors and psychiatrists, and even nurse. The family members ranged from moms, dads, children, close friends. But the purpose was that each person had with them two close people. So they formed, by definition, a triad, a little clan. So we had eight of these little clans. And Trish and Anne and myself formed, in a sense, our own clan. Mm. We were the clan of elders, the wise statesmen or stateswomen. And basically, we provided them the guide for the journey. We stimulated them. We asked them to come up with names for their clans, for imaginary names for themselves, for emblems. They had to dress up in costume. They had to design dances. They had to come up with songs. And all of this was to try and get them to identify closer and closer with this mythological journey. You need to do that. You need to push people to risk and become artistic and creative in order to access that mythological world. Every now and then we would ring a little bell, bring people back to reality, and see whether that playing that we did, that playing in that dream world, whether that provided them with more information about their physical being and also about the relationships between the family and the therapist. And we found just fascinating information that occurred as a result of that. Of course, we did this as a research study. We filmed it, and it now is a film that...
Is that video available?
The video is available. It's called The Healing Journey. And it's through ARC Films. And I don't actually have the number here.
But it is available to the public.
It is available to the public, and it's appeared on Knowledge Network and on Vision TV numerous times. The scientific aspect of that, which made it interesting, not only were we on this great mythological journey, but we were trying to record it and measure it. And we used interviews, using the camera to interview a person before and after the workshops, and then 6 months later, we asked people to fill out various scales that measured mood and well-being. Now, the interesting thing that happened is that we looked at our results, and we found that generally, as would be expected, the well-being of people improved. If you go through such a play dream sequence, you're going to feel better at the end of it. And not only that, you're going to feel better 6 months later. That's as far as we've gone with our measurement. We also looked at mood, and there was only one statistically significant result, and that was that the mood of one of those three groups increased significantly 6 months later, but to
Why is that statistical significant?
Well, I'm going to ask you, if you had to guess, would you think it was the patient group, the therapist group, or the family member group? Which of those three groups, having gone through such a process, do you think would have the greatest improvement in mood 6 months after the workshops? So if you just had to guess.
I would have thought the patient.
I would have thought so as well.
It's not?
The therapist group. Now, when I thought back on that, what came to mind is the fact that therapists who are healthcare givers, there's a huge amount of burnout. There's a lot of stuff
that is
kept in because of our professional attitude. They were the most resistant group to get into the process because it was difficult for them to throw away their professional veneer and become human beings and play and share and risk and cry and laugh. It was very difficult. However, after half a workshop, they were in it. And they actually did the most, they did the most movement.
Wonderful.
So that's an interesting result, I think, that bears thought.
Very, very interesting, Cecil. Now, in this connection, you're in your work, you're a doctor, you're also a therapist, and you're dealing with a lot of pain around you. And yet you look very carefree and happy, and I know one of the things that you probably do that does help you and keep you from burnout is that you use drama in your therapy, and you also are an actor. You study drama also, am I right?
Right, I study acting once a week, and I've done it for a number of years.
Does that help you?
It does, because I always say this, that if you really study acting deeply, for the full motivation, it is in itself a therapeutic experience. It is an insight-enhancing experience. It's a risky experience. And I think every time you push somebody to risk, take me out of my comfortable environment and put me on an environment that's slightly uneasy, I'm pushed to my limits. And I think that's what acting can do for someone. I've also found that acting makes you commit to an action. You have to make an action in order to act. You have to commit to that. And that is good for somebody to do even in real life.
That's right. And you get all those wonderful characters that you become and perhaps are in you.
Exactly.
Or
I think that an actor, why people enjoy acting is that it gives you that permission, that freedom to access parts of you that you probably normally would never do, to become a Nazi soldier. To become an abusive father, to become a loving person.
Right.
there may be areas of you that you don't do it enough, or never do.
That is a healthy thing. Do you feel that in our society, a lot of people go through life with only one hat, and they're sort of forced into it? You know, someone will go through their whole life as, say, a lawyer, and not play, and you know, it's the mortgage, and times are tough in the 90s, and there are other parts of their being that are not explored.
Yeah.
This happens a lot. I see it a lot around us, and does that account for a lot of anguish or emotional problems?
Well, I
things
think
are
it
held
does.
Inside?
I think it does. I think everything that I've said to you up to now does, in some sense, rely on the fact that you've got the energy to even examine what I've said to you and even try it out. Mm-hmm. But I'll give you a good example. Many of the chronic pain patients have lost their jobs. Their families have split up. Mm-hmm. They're under tremendous financial hardship. And on top of all that, they're not believed because many of the tests are normal.
Right.
Think about that. Think about dealing with chronic pain that's real to you, mm-hmm. that nobody believes that you have, that you've lost your job, your family's broken up. That's an amazing load. And now I come along and I say, well, I want you to play and I want you to, mm-hmm. you know, it's very hard.
Mm-hmm.
So I think what you said is right. In lesser sense, it occurs all throughout our society. We've become too rigid, too compartmentalized. Yeah. The stress of just living and surviving is tremendously hard.
Yeah.
That it's not easy to think of all these other aspects and then to do them.
Mm-hmm.
It is difficult.
Yeah, I mean, look at children. They're natural actors, dancers, and they lose that. But we can get back to it. You've got a busy life and demanding life, and you're getting back to it. So there is a possibility people have to make a priority.
You make a priority.
To play and...
The priority I made was to work 4 days in my practice.
Yeah.
And granted, that gave me enough money to then take the 1 day off and put that towards my acting, my storytelling, and even my research. So... And those are not the areas that I get any money from.
That's right.
But I did it. I made that priority, and it was quite difficult. It was like a psychological barrier to say I am not going to earn one-fifth of what I could earn, but I'm going to put it into areas of my life that I find rewarding and exciting.
And you're enjoying life more.
And I love it.
Than if you had, say, a bigger house or a bigger car or X amount of dollars more.
Exactly.
You're also a storyteller, as we mentioned in the intro. You performed recently in Toronto at the festival there. And you mentioned that you might do a story for us.
Well, I'd love to do a story.
There's so much to talk about in the interview, but is it going to be quite short?
I'll try and make it a short story. And I think I wanted to just illuminate to you the fact that if you tell stories that are personal, they in themselves reflect a journey, and therefore you can use your own personal storytelling as a therapeutic experience, and anybody can do it.
Okay. Can we have a story?
Well, I'll tell you this short story. It's a story about when I lived in South Africa, and at that time I lived in a little village called Ficksburg, which was on the banks of the Caledon River. And that's the boundary between the Orange Free State, which is part of South Africa, and Lesotho, or as it was called in those days, Basutoland, which was an independent country. And my parents had moved to Ficksburg, and they owned the new Ficksburg Hotel. And when I was there, I was about 6 years old. And the memory I have is coming out on a Saturday afternoon. I was 6 years old. I was standing there kicking sand, and there was this blue sky and just this heavy heat. And no noise, just distant buzzing of bees in an orchard. And I looked up, and I saw next to the front stoop, or front veranda of the Ficksburg Hotel, I saw a circle of black men. And at the head of that circle, I could see Sidwell. Now Sidwell was the head waiter of the new Ficksburg Hotel. And I knew he was the head waiter because he wore a red sash. And next to Sidwell was Isaac. And Isaac, I remembered, was the man who always caught the chickens for Friday night supper. Well, they were just sitting there and they were drinking coffee out of big enamel mugs. And they were eating these big doorsteps of bread. And Sidwell looked up and he saw me standing there all alone. And he said to me, he said, "Hey, little master, come here, come join us." And they opened up their circle, and I entered their little circle. And they greeted me in the traditional Sotho way. They said, Dumela, Sapila, Antlahulu. And they smiled and they made me feel so much part of this big group of black men. And they said, do you want to learn magic tricks? I said, great, I'll, sure. And I remembered, it took me the whole afternoon, but I still remember the one magic trick they taught me. And this is what the magic trick was. When you put your hand over someone's face, and then you can take their nose from their face and make it appear in your hand. This is the trick, the magic trick of Sidwell's hand. And then you could put it back on someone's face. And I remember feeling so proud, and they all laughed with me, and they said, wow, and I knew this trick, and I carried away their laughter and being part of this group. And it was about 7 years or 8 years later when we'd moved back to Cape Town, to the city, when I actually learned another meaning of Sidwell's black hand. Because you see, in the context of South Africa in those days as a teenager, this was a rude gesture. It was a demeaning gesture.
Right.
And I remember to this day having that gesture made to me, mm-hmm. and remembering 6 years back the laughter, that magic trick, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and realizing mm-hmm. that Sidwell, my hero, big black Sidwell, that their laughter wasn't really laughter that embraced me, but was laughter that demeaned me. They were really laughing at my white skin, the fact that I was the little white master, yes. and my father was their big white master, right. and this was their way to get back at me. And I carried that hurt, that anger, mm-hmm. I literally carried it with me for years. And it was only a few years ago when I'd got to Canada and I'd actually gone on a visit to Brazil, mm-hmm. when I learned the third and final meaning of Sidwell's black hand.
What is it?
As I got off the plane and I got into the airport, piled up on souvenir tables were replicas of Sidwell's hand. I couldn't believe it. Hanging from the ceilings, yeah. in the shop windows were these hands. And I went up to the souvenir seller and I said to her, I said, what is the meaning of Sidwell's black hand? And she said to me, this is actually a symbol of love. It's a symbol of fertility. It's a symbol of protection. It's what the black slaves wore around their necks when they were forcibly taken from Africa to South America. Mm-hmm. This is what warded off the evil eye.
Hmm.
And that's when the circle closed, because everything, that anger, that sense of betrayal just left me. Because I realized then that Sidwell, my hero, my friend, mm-hmm. big black Sidwell,
mm-hmm.
he had given me the only gift he could give his little white master, and that was his protection.
That's a beautiful story, Cecil. Beautiful, beautiful, and incredible. Incredible, the three phases, mm-hmm. and how things come full mm-hmm. circle.
I think the message yeah. behind stories is that sometimes a seed of a story yeah. can start at one time in your life.
Yeah.
But it may only end 25 years later.
As you went through your journey.
As I go through my journey, as you can look back through the yeah. tunnel of time, and you can look back at all the things that have happened to you, whether it's a catastrophe,
yeah.
pain,
yeah.
a breakup, a loss of a job. It may be traumatic at the time you have it, but as you go through the tunnel of life, it becomes part of the journey, and you begin to see it in the context of the circle.
You, for many years, it took you, 10 years or so before you could talk about your experiences in South Africa?
Yeah, I think leaving South Africa 20 years ago was for me a great wounding. Mm-hmm. I think it's a wounding.
Why did you leave?
I left because I couldn't live anymore as a young white adult in a society where it was the majority were unfairly treated. Just fundamentally, they could not have the same potential. Could not have the same opportunities as I could have. And I think, forget about politics, I just thought about it practically. I couldn't live a split life. I couldn't live saying on one hand, this is unfair, it's unfair that the majority can't go to university, can't travel, can't have equal jobs, and yet I slip back into a comfortable middle class existence with money and job opportunity and university education, I just couldn't keep living
there. Did you feel these things as a child?
No.
Did you question?
No. I think as a child, it was a magic place. The story of Sidwell.
Yeah.
It was magical. And it was within the zone. Everything was accepted as a child. This was the way things were. And it was only as a young adult that I began to question things, that I realized I had to make a commitment. I had to say, I'd either say I'm for it for these reasons or I'm against it for these reasons. And then once I'd made the commitment, I knew that I couldn't live there. Mm-hmm. And then my wife and I, with our little baby, left. And again, we were lucky that we could get into Canada easily. And we've been citizens since then.
How did you feel upon the change in South Africa? Did that bring a little joy to your heart?
Yes, I think that's part of the healing.
Yeah.
I think that when I started to tell the story that I just told you, among many other stories of my South African experience, it was a form of healing. Mm-hmm. And it seemed to occur at about the same time that the same transitions were occurring in South Africa.
Now, when you were in South Africa, you were an engineer, you were not a doctor, but you know, that's going to have to be for another interview. As I mentioned to you earlier, the half hour goes by so quickly, and we didn't get into your research at UBC and the wonderful work you're doing with people with polio and without any life in their arms, helping them to function.
Okay.
That's for another interview. So on that note, we're going to have to wrap up for today, Dr. Hershler, Cecil. Oh.
Thank you so much
for coming down and sharing with us, and good luck with your hero's journey. And can people call you? Can they come and see you?
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, because my practice is small, sometimes people have to wait.
Yeah.
But
you're in the book.
I'm in the book, and
yeah,
I'm there.
Dr. Cecil Hershler.
Right.
Thanks again, and we'll be doing part two very soon.
Thank you.
Good luck to you, and see you again. I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank Andersons for providing this lovely setting for the interviews. For Contact, I'm Gloria Crichton. Please join us next time.